Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. My name is John Adams. Hey, if you're new here, welcome. I'm so glad to see you around. And if you're not, just a real quick housekeeping thing, you may see a difference. The channel has been called All of Grace. I decided to change it just to my name, John Adams. And if you're looking for the URL, it's John Adams Ministries. The reason I did that, I was having so many people who were confused. They were like, what in the world does that even mean, All of Grace? And so instead of having to explain it over and over and over, I just figured let's simplify it right now, call it by my name. This is my channel anyways, it's my teaching, and so why not do that just to make it simple and easy for everybody. But today's topic, we are talking about doubt, doubting God. If you have been a Christian for any amount of time, you know what it feels like to doubt either the existence of God or the character of God, and in those times, it feels terrible. So if that's you, keep watching today's video. You know, as believers, we go through seasons that are good seasons, amazing seasons, and we go through seasons that are terrible and it's stretching and it's hurtful, but yet God uses every single one of those seasons to bring Himself more glory and to advance us further and deeper into the character of Christ. And one of these seasons that we go through is this season of doubt. I know for me, seasons of doubt are extremely difficult. Now, if you've been a believer and you go to church and you're struggling with doubt, it can be one of the most lonely feelings that you've ever experienced to understand that you are in a room filled with people who are passionate about the Lord and they're excited about the Lord, and yet you are struggling with doubt. It is so disheartening. And in these seasons, we feel like we're just stuck there. One way that I can explain it, it's this feeling of being stuck at sea, adrift in a lifeboat. There's nothing you can do to get out of it. Nowhere you look around yourself is there any land to kind of plant your feet down and get sturdy again. And you are just bobbing up and down with the waves of emotion of what it feels like to doubt the God that you love so much. Now, in my experience, there's two major areas of doubt that people struggle with. First, it's the existence of God. Like, does God actually exist? That's a huge issue, and we want to deal with that. But something that's kind of a little bit deeper down, especially for the Christian, is what do we do when we're doubting the character or the nature of God? Like, what do we do when we feel like we can't trust that God is loving, or we don't trust the moral standard, the moral bar that the Lord has set? What do we do when we doubt that God is patient with us, or that God is kind to those who call upon His name? What do we do when we are filled with doubt? I think one of the bigger doubts that people have right now is do they trust the sovereignty of God in this coronavirus season? I mean, there's so much craziness going on around us, and it's really easy to doubt this idea or this truth that God is in control of the entire universe, that Christ is literally holding every molecule in the galaxy together by the word of His power. And it's just hard at times to think, man, is God really in control when there's all this craziness going on? So I think this is a time for us to just get honest with ourselves. Get honest, have we dealt with doubt? Are we currently dealing with doubt? It's okay, it's something that's so natural to who we are. It's not, you know, obviously it's one of those things we wanna deal with, but it's not a thing that would like disqualify you from the kingdom of God because you're doubting. Everybody doubts. I mean, you look in the scriptures, guys who are standing with Jesus Himself are still doubting, so it's normal that we would doubt as well. But in order to deal with the problem of doubt, we have to understand the nature of doubt. Like, what is it even? The first thing we see about doubt is that doubt's not final. It's not your final identity. We live in a time where people are so fast to try to put any kind of thing and say, this is my identity. We love putting things in labels, but doubt is not your identity. Doubt's just the space between faith and disbelief, and you're somewhere in that line all the time. I mean, seriously, think about what it was like for the apostles or the disciples to be with Jesus, to see the miracles of Christ. You have Thomas even. He saw the miracles of Christ. He saw the risen Christ, and he still dealt with doubt. Again, we try to put on the identity of doubt. It's like when you watch a brand new believer, they just came to love Jesus, and they think that that mountaintop high, they will ride that thing for the rest of their lives. But we all know that eventually that comes down, and your discipleship to Jesus just becomes more solid in that moment. It's not an emotional high. It's like, this is your day in and day out belief. Well, that's the same, that high doesn't last for those people, and that's not their identity. That's the same with when you're doubting. That's not your identity. That season doesn't last forever. And so you don't need to be worried about it if you're in a season. All you need to do is just keep putting one foot in front of the other, walking and following Jesus. You know, a scripture comes to mind for me when thinking about doubt. I like to go back to Peter. Peter's just such an amazing character in the Bible. And Matthew 14, 22 through 33 says this, "But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, 'It's a ghost.' And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, 'Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid.' And Peter answered him, 'Lord, if it's you, command me to come to you on the water.' And he said, 'Come.' So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind and he was afraid and beginning to sink, he cried out, 'Lord, save me.' Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying, 'Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?' And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshiped him, saying, 'Truly, you are the Son of God.'" Of God. You see, this is one of those examples of doubting the character of God. Like, why would Jesus use the word doubt in this moment? Because Peter was willing to jump out of the boat after Jesus. None of the other disciples were able to say that. But what happened was Peter got out of the boat and he saw the craziness of what was going on around him. He took his eyes, his faith, his belief off of the sovereignty of Christ being able to hold all creation together, and he started to doubt, and so he started to sink. So if Peter was like us, he might take that moment where he sunk and he might have thought like, man, that's my identity. I'm a doubter, I'm a failure, but that's not who Peter was. And when you're in those seasons, that's not who you are. For those moments when you're struggling, like that struggle, that's not the truest thing about you. The truest thing about you is that you are a child of God. And with that as your identity, that identity in Christ is strong enough to weather every single storm that you will ever come across in your life. So if it's true that we are not our doubt and that our doubt is not our identity, what are just some practical tips in order to help expel doubt from our lives? If it's kind of taking up all the space in our minds, what can we do to help develop ourselves, keep our eyes on Christ, and move past these seasons of doubt? The first thing you need to do is doubt your doubt. If it's true that this is not your identity, you need to make sure that you are doubting those feelings of doubt that are popping into your mind. And you can do this in two ways. The first way is by doubting where it is that these thoughts, these doubts are coming from. The reality is you have a very real enemy that wants you to doubt the King of Glory. The scriptures say this over and over. 1 Peter 5:8, he says, "Be sober minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour." We see this again in the book of John, John 8:44. He says, "You are of your father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies." And so you have an enemy that day and night is going to be trying to whisper doubts into your mind so that you would doubt the character of God, that you would doubt the existence of God. And so there are times where I'll get doubts and I'll just be like, "Look, devil, you have overplayed your hand. I don't need to listen to this." And sometimes that's enough to just like get rid of that doubt right then and there. But if that doesn't work, then I think I move on to the second thing, which is to actually argue back against my doubts. You know, I think a great way to kind of argue against the doubts that we have is to learn just simple and basic apologetics. There's tons of information out there. I think one guy who does it great is a guy named Mike Winger. I will link to his YouTube channel below. But if we can learn very basic apologetics, then when those simple doubts come into our mind, it's really easy to expel them. Because like I said, God has created this world and he's created it with order. And so sometimes for me, I need to remind myself of that order in order to get rid of the doubts that are plaguing my mind. Another great book, I mean, this is, I think, probably the best book about this, is just Mere Christianity. It's C.S. Lewis. It's probably his most famous book other than The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, that whole series. But I would highly recommend just finding somebody who studies apologetics and preaches apologetics, someone you like that you connect with, and learn as much as you can, because it is really helpful. The second thing you can do when you're in a season of doubt is, I had a counselor one time, he called it mind your P's and Q's. Look, these seasons just happen to everybody. There's nothing that you can do about it. And if you use that season to kind of back off from the way that you know that you should normally live, you're kind of wasting your time. And so we always, as believers, we should always continue to be doing what Christ has set before us. We should always be making disciples. We should always be connecting with the Lord in His Word. We should always be in prayer. We should always be doing these things that Christ has given us in the disciplines of the faith as just ordinary means of connecting with God. Because when that season of doubt is over, the kindling of our heart is prepared to be set back aflame by the Holy Spirit. The final thing that we can do in order to help ourselves with our doubt is to remind ourselves of the character of Christ. It's true, Christ was so comforting to the doubter. Christ was patient with the doubter. Christ didn't hear a doubter's words and instantly be like, you know what, you're not good enough for the kingdom. No, Christ was compassionate for the doubter. And we see that really clearly in John 20, verse 24 through 29. It says this, "Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, 'We have seen the Lord.' But he said to them, 'Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my fingers into the mark of nails, and place my hands into his side, I will never believe.'" You can imagine that is an enormous amount of doubt that he would say this. Let's get back into it. 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. And although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet believed." And like I said, Jesus' reaction was not to push Thomas away, but it was through kindness to draw Thomas near to himself and meet him in that place of doubt and overcome those doubts. And so doubt's a really tricky thing. It's a really serious thing, because if you don't deal with it, it'll fester and grow and grow. But we gotta ask the question, is it okay to doubt God? Well, the answer is both yes and no. It's normal to doubt God. Is it okay to sit there? No. So we have tools that we've just learned that we can fight back against our doubt. Doubting our doubts, doing what we know that we're supposed to do in our life, and then also leaning on the character of Christ, reminding our hearts of what we already know to be true about Christ, those things help us in serious seasons of doubt. And the way that we weather those storms, it has everything to do with how we will grow as a disciple. You can weather the storm of doubt with an open heart towards God, where you want to see more of the beauty of God, or you can have a closed heart towards God, where you're just scared that God's gonna be so mad at you, and that's just not the God that we serve. Guys, thank you so much for watching. Go ahead and subscribe to the channel. I love y'all. We'll see you in the next video.